Hello, how's it going, boys? How are you, Michael and Callum?
Yeah, not bad, thanks.
Hello.
Thanks for having us on.
Sensational.
Yeah.
Don't know who's getting better, Tash, me or you, Husty?
I'll just not comment on that and let the audience decide. Maybe they can put a poll up. But
No,
you've got a pretty substantial one, I would say.
it's been years in the making, though. I lost all this hair to get this tash, so I'll tell you that.
Had to get
See,
hair
Mike was
somewhere, you know.
following yesterday when the bandana tied to the cedars.
Yeah,
I think Mick's doing all right. It's your brother Josh. I've been like that. Josh, shave that. Get that shave for years.
again, I won't comment just because we know how karma works with hair sometimes, so I'll just be quiet and just thank that it's
Man. So, yeah, this is a nice wee episode for the Scottish Running Podcast. So, I've got Michael and Callum on from Stride Athletics. So, I was meant to get yous on before you had your flat and fast 5K, but just
still
didn't
there.
get away from us. And but from what I see, it was a great event. So, and we're going to be speaking a good bit about the Scottish cross country scene that's coming up. Well, it's already started happening. We'll have a couple of results this weekend there, but we're going to be speaking about, a lot of our predictions, what we think is going to happen, what individuals we think are going to really come to the fore this year, etc. No, I can no men, women. Vets, the vet scene as well. The vet scene pretty mental. There's that much competition in the vet scene cross country just now. So, and Michael and Callum have got a plethora of running experience. Not as much as me, but they've got a plethora of it. And but they both run faster than me as well. So that's so a bit more about first of all Stride Athletics. So, what you introduce yourself? So, how did Stride Athletics come about?
Yeah, so basically, it wasn't one of these things where maybe somebody sets out a sort of master plan and thinking I want to sort of set up a podcast or something. It was basically just I was working out towards Linlithgow and yeah, I came across this cycle circuit. It was getting built and it quite reminded me quite similar to the sort of Barrowfield course we did at the podium and started thinking I was that'd be quite a good race. And then I was like, I don't know if they'll put a race on. I was like, maybe I should just put a race on. So that was the sort of the first thinking of it. And then sort of spoke to a few boys in the training group at Canvas Lang and they were like, oh nah, wouldn't work, it wouldn't work. And that was it, sort of pushed to the back of the mind. And then one of the things we just really maybe can't stop thinking about it, sort of thing. So I said to a few other people when it started sort of getting a bit of momentum, said to a couple of friends and they were like, yeah, they would love to help out. And then messaged Michael to see if he'd be interested as well. And like, yeah, it just sort of grew from there. So they went from Michael, came in, so there's four of us, and then we got Ewan Rose, who was a Glasgow Uni president when me and Michael were at Cali, to come in, and then a boy called Theo Phillips. He's doing all sort of videography stuff. So I just sort of went from there. The initial plan was obviously hosting the flat and fast 5K, and then I just started having a sort of feeling that if it was any other sport and the sort of strength and depth that they've got at the moment and that sort of sport, there'd be a lot more sort of publicity and like maybe sort of a lot more recognition for the sport and what's going on. Obviously, I think if football, for example, was having a sort of success that people are obviously Laura Muir, Josh Kerr winning world championships and stuff like that. Like you'd be on the back pages every day and walking in the streets getting stopped for pictures and there's not really any, although I don't think Laura and Josh would want to be getting stopped every 2 seconds for photos. It'd be nice for them to get some recognition and also the other people. So yeah, it just sort of came from there and just sort of trying to for a sort of love for the sport and maybe giving back a little bit and just trying to get some recognition for all levels of runners. I think obviously are people obviously in this day and age and the sort of social media runners are sort of coming to the fore and like maybe they are starting to get a slightly more respect of like what these people do at all levels, whether that be like a sub 30 10K person or somebody right up to 50 minutes. Like it does take a lot of work and yeah, I think most folks sacrifice a lot to get to that level and probably train most days. So it was just about sort of getting the sort of recognition in the sport and just sort of promoting athletes within Scotland and yeah, giving back to the sport a little bit. Yeah, I think Mike would probably agree. That's where we're sort of just trying to stick to that sort of core sort of set of values as we sort of obviously gained quite a bit of traction. It was only May time we started it. So 5 months, we've, yeah, quite gathered quite an audience to be fair. It's quite nice. Got a sort of quite a loyal group of people backing us and stuff like that and had quite a lot of nice feedback after the race. So yeah, it's been quite a nice surprise to be honest.
A nice one. That's kind of why myself and Pete started this podcast as well. For me, there was a lot of YouTubers out there, saying that it was a running podcast, but what they do is they just They just film themselves
Yeah.
running and saying, "Oh, hey there, guys!" And you're like, "No, it's not really giving people information, etc. They're not really getting guests on. They're just kind of talking about themselves, etc." And I completely agree with you. I mean, Josh Kerr, world champion, he was in the news for about a day,
I
done.
thought, yeah, mental.
But something will happen at a football game in Scotland, and it's in the news on football phone-ins for weeks. And they're like, they've not. Like one thing, they've not even won anything. No, in Britain, never mind Europe. Whereas Josh Kerr, Laura Muir, etc., like Eilish McColgan, Gemma Rike, Kayleigh Hutchinson, all these people, they're all smashing out at the world level, and it literally just gets, oh, whatever. But it's just a bit annoying. So it's really good to, get that out there.
And I think one thing that we realized collectively, and we all kind of came like I remember the first time that Callum messaged me about one idea, which I'll just keep quiet because I think both of us quite like the idea, but we want to let it simmer for a bit and then hopefully work on it in the future. Was I had an idea for a documentary, and it's kind of one of these weird things. I'm probably not the only person that's thought about this idea, but it was along those lines of, right, we do have these elite athletes who are fantastic, but also I look at people who can run a 30-minute 10K, or even people at the kind of similar level of me and Callum, where we're pretty strong club runners, but we're not at that teasing on the Scottish side too much, but we're still really, really dedicated to what we do. And I thought there's so many good stories out there. There's so many people from elite clubs in terms of like the high-end Scottish running clubs who are working their socks off, sacrificing a lot. Their families sacrificing a lot as well. I think we're all quite lucky that we've got partners, or we've had partners who are willing to let us have that space to train. And occasionally, when they want to lie in bed on a Sunday morning, you're like, nah, well, I've got to go and do like a 13-mile run or something like that. So I remember thinking about that as an idea. And Callum messaged me, I think maybe the start of the year, and he said he had a similar idea, and I was like, mate, I've literally thought about this as well. And it's kind of one of those things that when we first talked about it, to be honest, I was a little bit not sure how the media side would work, because when he came to me, he wasn't saying anything about a race at that point. He was just telling me from a media side, this is maybe we should do videos and this and that. And I don't know why, but in my head I was like, I don't know if we could do that. To be honest, I didn't think that we would get the audience that we could get. I was probably a little bit too negative, probably thinking, who would watch us, and is it more effort than what it's worth and all this kind of stuff. And over time, eventually, when we started to get people together, as Callum said, when we got you and Rose in, Theo Phillips-Smith, Murray Beattie, who was there from the start as well, when we got these people in who are really working on it every single day, and at least on my side, Theo is doing a lot of work. He does a lot of the filming, for example. We started to see things kind of come together. And yeah, like I said, like me and Callum have worked together at our university at Cali when we were president and vice president, and when I left, Callum became the president, and we had a lot of success together. A really good team with different ideas and different ways of thinking, to be honest. Different kind of like I'm quite like a realist, which is not always a good thing, and he's a dreamer, which is again not always a good thing, and In
something you need to
the
and some things you need to balance out, and it's funny because sometimes when I was at uni, I was like, yeah, maybe we need to do this or we need to do that, and sometimes I'd be wrong, sometimes he'd be wrong, and I'm absolutely more than happy to admit on camera, on the record, that my initial concerns with what became Stride were I was the one that was in the wrong. So I'm more than happy to admit that. And yeah, so and again, just the level of interest we got, just not only on the media side, but on the interest in a race when we'd never put on a race before. All we really had behind us was
the fact that Ewan had organised quite a few races when he was at Glasgow Uni, and for us to say, oh, well, look, you know, take a chance, and people took a chance when we really didn't have a lot of content. We had no experience as a group that they would know of. Was just amazing.
I really like that. I like your thought process there. You know, because we see, you know, you get what was one of the America, like Flow Track, etc. That was, you know, quite a big, you get a social media kind of website, videos, etc. Then you get like City S Mag, and they'll get access to, you know, like elite athletes doing documentaries on them. And but I really like that idea of, you know, the club runner, you know, in Scotland, because there's that many. I mean, there's hundreds of thousands of club runners who, like, for example, run maybe like 2:30 for the marathon, which is an incredible time. I'll put in a ton of training. I know myself, like, training for a marathon, it's 3 months of your life where you need to hit every single session, every single easy run. You can't go for a night out because it will affect the, you know, it will affect the next day's run, etc. You need to be on your best behavior for 3 months of life, you know, a quarter of the year. And then people just see the end result, you know, maybe just see on your Strava, oh, well done, but don't see all that behind. And I think I would say it's actually harder for a club runner to achieve their goals because you need to go and work full time if you get a family and you get kids and they need to fit in, say, that marathon training on top of that. Whereas a full time athlete, yeah, it's still hard work. It's still a lot of hard work, but you go out for a run, done. Go to the gym, that's fine. You've not got any stresses, none of this, none of that. Like, I just think from the club runner point of view, I think there's a lot to be said for in terms of like perceived effort and probably mental toughness and getting your training done and achieving those results as well.
Yeah, I totally agree. Like, I think that was one of the sort of main things in my thinking for Stride at the start was initially like you've obviously got things like Sweat Elite, which predominantly is just sort of elite athletes, but then you also get, like you mentioned earlier, the sort of like the race day vlogs where people will sort of focus on themselves, or maybe 9 times out of 10 are just maybe the sort of plodders and stuff like that. Obviously no offense to plodders, but you know what I mean. So I wanted to try and create something, obviously, with looking, like Michael said, maybe sort of all right club runner level, sort of like having quite good sort of connections. I wanted to try and bring everyone into focus and try and like for example, like the race where like have a level of all abilities could come to the same sort of night and sort of mingle and sort of everyone could just get the recognition they deserve. And I think that sort of making through quite well, and hopefully can build on it. Obviously having the sort of the D race through to the A race where everyone sort of stayed to cheer each other on, which I think was quite nice. But yeah, initially like I wanted to sort of just be behind the scenes. I didn't really want anyone to know it was me doing stuff and all that. I just wanted to sort of the athletes to be sort of primarily focused. But obviously as things start getting about and Scottish Athletics start tweeting build on Callum and team and stuff like that, it gets a bit harder to stay anonymous. But nah, it's been nice, and like I still don't want to sort of to be that person that's in front of the camera 24/7. I'm quite keen, obviously, like, to sort of have the athlete as a sort of four. But obviously, we've got Michael and Theo and Murray who are all quite good in front of the camera. So I think going forward, that maybe we'll always try and get in front of the camera a bit more and try and sort of maybe put a face to the brand so folk can maybe can relate a bit more going forward, which would be nice. But nah, yeah, like you said, I think it's just about trying to just sort of shine a light on the sort of varied, sort of wide nature of athletics and running in Scotland, because it is, in my opinion, like absolutely brilliant. Like it's probably one of the most represented sports in the UK, and it really does deserve some more recognition and support.
Yeah,
Yeah, and I
definitely.
think I was just going to say on top of that as well is you know, we, as you were talking about, we see a lot of these vlogs, not blogs, but we do see blogs, I guess, of it as well, where we see people who are centered on themselves, which again, I think we had a good discussion about this the other day, because everyone's got different approaches. But I think that any way that you can get someone into running, or any way that you can get people to recognize the achievements of people who are running and training and, you know, all that kind of stuff, is good for the sport. And there will be people who won't be interested in what we do, but then we aren't always interested in some of the content that other people are making that we might look at and be like, it's not for us. So, you know, we're always looking to improve on what we're doing, improve the content. We've got some ideas that are coming out hopefully in the next couple of months. But at the same time, we just are really trying to be I hate saying the word, but we're really trying to be authentic with what we're doing. We're not trying to, you know, pretend that we're something we're not. We are really just focused on telling the stories of athletes and what's been so good so far. And I think it is kind of representative of all athletes is that we're quite egotistical people. Like everyone's got a little bit of a, you know, everyone's got a little bit of something where they, you know, they want to get that segment on Strava, or they're trying to be, I mean, even just trying to beat your PB, getting a good photo from a race. Like everyone's trying to get something to be like, hey, look what how I've done. And you know, there's not many people who don't do that. Which again is fine because everyone wants a bit of recognition for what they've done. And I think what we're finding is a lot of people also want to interact with us. It's not like we're chasing people trying to get them on the channel. We've got like lists of people who are like, hey, can I be involved? And I think the more that we do, the more that we're gonna see that. And hopefully, you know, we always want to keep it focused on Scotland, but we hopefully can get people from all over the UK, people from all over the world at times, who can really kind of shine a light on how fantastic the, as Callum was saying, how fantastic the sport is in Scotland and how kind of underreported it is really.
Yeah, because like you're saying there, but getting kind of folks in Scotland that we got on Tin Man, the coach from America, and most of the time he just spoke about runners from the UK. He like, oh, I love Steve Ovett and all that. He's barely talking about, I thought he was going to talk about no coaching in America and all that. He was just talking about UK running, and he's like
Yeah.
saying how much the Scottish guys were smashing him. Like,
I
you
think
go.
even just on that, we've actually had a couple of NCAA like coaches messaging us about meeting up and stuff like that when they came over and sort of scouting things to speak about athletes, which is pretty cool. At first I was like, why are they messaging us? But obviously we get quite a decent sort of exposure now. We maybe have a sort of market we can tap into. So yeah, like I don't know how it'll work going forward, but it's quite cool maybe having that opportunity to where we can maybe obviously give something back to sort of younger ones or whoever wants to go to university and stuff like that. But it's quite cool like sort of having them come to us and stuff like that and see how, because yeah, and maybe it's maybe just sort of like this is just sort of shifting slightly to maybe more towards the sort of 21st century. Because I don't know if Michael you were aware, but at the race at Flat and Fast a couple of weeks ago, we get told that apparently a couple of the sort of officials and stuff like that and people were a bit judgy about us because we were basically like, who are these people coming in and all that? They're quite young and things like. Obviously, Mike was 28 when he's getting on now, but
Cheeky bastard.
but yeah, it was a wee bit like sort of obviously, I think people maybe are sort of stuck in their ways in some sort of aspects in the sport, so maybe it is a good thing, maybe a bit refreshing going forward that maybe people can. And obviously, Mary McLennan and stuff like that, I've got the thing that she's doing for the sort of women in sport, and it's a bit of a breath of fresh air, maybe having the sort of younger ones, obviously yourself, Sean. Obviously, you're not too old these days, but getting this sort of, like I said, that's sort of breath of fresh air and just trying to, yeah, like I think most folk, I agree that most folk involved in athletics are maybe sort of the older, maybe more retired sort of ladies and gentlemen these days. So it is nice maybe having a sort of, keep saying breath of fresh air, but maybe it is just sort of opening a set another door and maybe just trying to get recruit like a sort of different audience, because I know we got some really nice feedback from the race that a lot of the younger ones really enjoyed it. And it was quite nice to see some actually younger children there, just the cowbells, ringing the cowbells and shouting folk on, and maybe, yeah, can inspire these sort of next future generations, just be given slightly more exposure to the athletes that deserve it.
Yeah,
Yeah, and
absolutely.
I think one thing is important as well, which was Callum was kind of touching on there, is that I feel that if we, and everyone who does something like this in Scottish athletics, including Scottish athletics themselves, who I think we can all agree do an amazing job to cover our sport, and they're really open to sharing really anyone's content as well,
shout out to Peter
which is important.
Jardine.
Yeah, big shout out to Peter and Sue. They do amazing on the comms team. You know, I think what Callum said about trying to get new people for a new generation involved in athletics in different ways is really important, because if we can like enfranchise people and get people kind of inspired, not just like inspired to become like the next Josh Kerr, Laura Muir or whatever, but being inspired to be involved in their clubs, to stick at the sport, to, you know, even if it's just going out for runs. It's a big part of the sport that I think a lot of people are struggling with right now. I mean, I've got my beliefs on why a lot of clubs are orientated around kind of older older people generally, and I think part of that is because we're all being squeezed a lot more when it comes to work compared to maybe 25 years ago or so. I think it's really starting to get a lot more intense, a lot more expectation from your employers in general, and I think as a result, I don't think we're getting to a point where it's getting a bit more flexible again, but I think for a lot of people, they are reluctant to help in their clubs, for example, because they're in, say, their 30s or their 20s, maybe their 40s, and they're like, well, I've not got time, I'm really busy, I've got kids, I've got so much stuff to do. And I just hope that what we're doing and what other people like, as Callum said, Mary McLennan, and you know, all these different people who are kind of our age, some are even younger than us, some are older than us, who are really saying, well, we've got to kind of keep this momentum going, that's important, and I hope people continue to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's, I think we're in a really lucky position just now as well with Scottish running. You've got role models, as in, you know, you had your low. For me, it all kind of started with like Chris O'Hare on the track scene. He, you know, he went to America and won the NCAAs. Then he was still based out there. Then he was representing Britain at Europeans, cross country and then again. Mainly on the track at the Worlds, the Olympics, and that as well. And that kind of gave birth to Gourlay, Josh Kerr, Jake Whiteman, and then you get your Laura Muir. And then because and Laura Muir, you had, you know, Gemma Reekie coming through with Laura Muir, and Laura Muir's Gemma Reekie's younger than Laura Muir, so I still think you can see a lot from her. But she's still a girl from Kilbarkin who's made Olympic finals regularly, and I think that really has to be celebrated. I think we're in a really good position now to really encourage, you know, the younger generation. And I think you can see that coming through a wee bit. I think there was a girl in Giffen called Erin Wallace.
Yep, we
When she was
am.
like 12 or 13, she ran at 9:30 for 3K, and everyone's like, we can. Now she's like, I don't know what age she is now, but she must be a lot older. But she's running some really good time. Like she's, you know, she's broke 2 minutes for 800 or so, but that's another generation that's came through, and that's a result of, you know, seeing likes of Laura Muir smash it up and get off of Dundee.
Yeah, it's meant to.
It's just got to be that, like, I mean, it helps having the people at the elite level. I think having that competitiveness at the top of the non-elite level is really important as well. And, you know, I think post-COVID as well, there's a few issues that athletics has went through. I know, like, me and Sean's local club, Inverclyde, struggled quite a bit just because we weren't able to all get out training together at some points. I think we're getting back there. But at the time, it was really hard, and I'm sure we weren't the only club that was struggling with that kind of stuff. And I think post-COVID, there has to be a real, like, a boot up the backside to get us to the point again where we've got, like, people at the front, and we're really championing those people who are leading the non-elite. And then hopefully, you know, those people can kick on and make the British finals, and then from British finals, hopefully make the European teams and stuff. And I think, yeah, we're in a really healthy position. I mean, I know you could argue a golden age came a few years ago, but the great thing about athletics is just, you know, you never know when the next star's going to come, and hopefully one's coming soon.
Yeah, we've got him right now. It's Josh Kerr.
After Josh Kerr.
After Josh.
After Josh Kerr. I mean, we do have, yeah, I mean, he's. Yeah, Josh is obviously incredible. When for like me and Callum ran against Josh, Jake, Neil, growing up, particularly, I think, just trying to remember what you were the year below me, Callum, weren't you?
Yeah.
But like Neil, we ran against most races because he was same district, same county as well. So, you know, we've raced against some of these guys who are now, you know, on another level, absolutely on another level. And just seeing where the next star is going to come is going to be really exciting.
Yeah, absolutely. And talking about stars, I think on Saturday there at the West Cross Country, I think they had an Olympic athlete winning in the last leg, Callum Hawkins. So it's actually quite good to see Callum back, you know, competing again in Scotland. I know he's had his injury troubles as well, but were you guys at the race?
I was. Yeah. Yeah, it was really nice to see Callum back. Obviously, you know, Callum quite well, so after Kilbarkin and stuff like that. Yeah, like you said, I had injury issues for that. So I don't think he was too happy with his own performance. But like you say, like, and the main thing for him was getting back racing and obviously getting around pain free. I think it was for a lot of folk, it was probably quite refreshing and nice to see somebody like Callum and what level he's been at competing at a competition. And also, like Laura Muir was handing out medals as well to the younger stuff, giving out kit. So, like you say, I think it's just about inspiring these sort of future generations. But yeah, like, yeah, West was really good. I think the weather wasn't the best, obviously. I think Michael was saying that McLeod couldn't get through and stuff, obviously, because of the rain there. But yeah, really challenging course. And I quite enjoyed racing it, to be honest. It was my first race in a while. It was nice to get back to it.
Nice. I know the Inverclyde, like, as a club captain, like, I seen all the videos and stuff, and I was just like, you know what, guys? I was like, don't even attempt to try and get through that. When there's people kayaking in the middle of the road, I don't think. And then there's people getting stranded in the middle of the road with their cars just getting flooded. I was like, if the rain's going to get worse, I was like, look, it's all right. It's only one race. So I think I made the same decision, but hopefully, come a national relay, there'll be no more weather to trap us in.
I'm sure Greene at Glen Park will be taking the high ground over you for a few weeks.
Most likely, most
Aye,
likely.
they did take the high ground. They all came for the port, so that is a wee bit higher than Greenock's.
I mean, fair play to them getting through. I mean,
Aye.
fair play to making that, getting that journey through that. I was at my girlfriend's house and I seen the, even at her house, she stays in a hill and the water was just coming right down. But no, her street was drivable, but you see down the bottom, then where Kartsdyke station was, you seen people wading through this water. And I was like, then the Arnold Clark Road, where Greenock is, the main road getting in, that was just like a swimming pool. And that was mental. But ah, well,
Yeah.
it's one race loss for Inverclyde, but well, there's plenty of other races there. But yeah, no, but thank you for that. I had some really good chat about Stride Athletics, and I just thought it'd be really good to get you guys on and give us a platform to really know, explain it all. And I'm looking forward to that documentary when if it goes to plan.
Yeah, me
But
too.
yeah, but yeah, but the reason I got you guys on because I've known you for a while, and you guys have got a lot of experience in the cross country scene in Scotland, and just get you on to chat about the because we're starting a brand new cross country season in Scotland. Obviously you were there on Saturday, Callum, and just to get you a right good chat about the commencation of the cross country scene in Scotland. So, what do you think about this season? So, Kilbarton have won the West. I think Stirling Uni won the
Yeah,
East.
Stirling Uni won the East,
They
didn't
did.
they? They
Yeah, they
won the
did.
East. But I've had loads of people tell me that Stirling Uni, that they are central runners, but I don't know if they get told to run for the Uni first. I don't know what's going on there,
Seems
but
Ben McMillan and Alistair Marshall ran for the Uni, but I wasn't too sure the other two boys are if they're central as well.
I can't remember off the top of my head either who they were, but I do know, for example, some athletes who, and I think they come from both of our clubs, Inverclyde and Callum at Camus Lang. We've got athletes who we can't select because they're effectively, it's kind of like the weirdest thing is that we're an amateur sport, but the universities have almost got like a contract, a paid contract with some athletes where they get grants if they run for the university, and as a result they have to run for the university. So we've got Peter Bradshaw on loan at Edinburgh, and I think with Ben and Alistair, I'm not too sure what happens with them in terms of nationals. I don't know if they need to stick at Stirling, because initially Stirling kind of surprised me. I know they've got a really good team out there. They always do really well at the unis, but you don't really see them, and Callum can maybe back me up on this, you don't really see them at nationals a lot of the time. So
No, I think that was the first time I've seen some. That was the first time they've won the East District relays before. So yeah, I agree. I've not seen them before at major competitions and stuff like that. Like,
it will be interesting, and obviously the interesting thing with the unis is that depending on what year you're in, you're either a senior or you're an under 20 when it comes to like post relays. So that's going to be, I can't sit there and I've not got the list in front of me, but that's going to be something that's worth considering when we're looking at who might win the West and East, and then who will win the Nationals in February and all that stuff. It's going to be interesting. But yeah, it was a bit surprising to see them win. But again, maybe that's because we weren't quite expecting Stirling to field the team with that kind of strength.
yeah, it's interesting. I mean, it mixes it up a bit, you know. Because obviously Nashville in February, no Central have won that 11 years in a row, you know. So like, it would be good to see other teams, you know, go up there and, you know, challenge them really close. But I know it's with the Peter Bradshaw one. Obviously, you know me, might come on the WhatsApp group always every season. I'm like, right, cross country, let's get at it, right? And Peter Bradshaw has been like, oh, I can't run from Inverclyde, I'm with Edinburgh Uni. I was like, so? And he's like, no, I need to go first playing with them. And I was like, I didn't know that was a thing just now. I was like, I was like, Peter, I'd be loving you in my team right now. The times he's ran and the season he's had, I'm just like, oh no. But I didn't realise that was a thing. I think if he's getting like grants, etc., apparently that's what it is. Maybe the same
That's
thing
exactly it.
for other unis. It's no, you're getting a grant. So yeah, effectively, hey, they're on loan from an athletics club, a 4-year contract, and then.
I mean, this is why Edinburgh Uni is so strong as well. I mean, the boys usually do pretty solid, and Glasgow Uni are doing all right at the moment as well. They were obviously second at the West, but it's really worth giving a massive shout out to Edinburgh Uni as well. The women's side is just like, it's ridiculous just the amount of teams they get in that top half. I think I saw, I could be wrong, but I think I saw three in the top five. And you know, the obviously it helps being from Edinburgh or Glasgow Uni. You can attract a lot of really good athletes from across the country, got a good coaching set up, and the unis themselves are really like high up on academic kind of tables. But you know, we've had people who were at our event Flat and Fast, Neve Carr, who won the women's race. She was involved in the team that I believe won. I could be wrong off the top of my head, but I believe they had two teams on the podium, and it's really worth giving them a shout out on the women's side for the East. And I actually missed, I was there on Saturday at the West, but only saw the senior men's race. I didn't quite get through in time for the women's, but maybe Callum can speak about that race. I don't know if he was too busy warming up or not.
I've seen the last couple of legs. Yeah, I was obviously cheering on the Camus Langeros, Trent Mullane. So, yeah, it's quite some strong runs involved there. I think obviously Camus Langeros had a really strong team. We thought in the Shiringra they were gonna win it, to be honest. but I think the Finola from Shettleston had some run in the last leg to claw and Stephanie Tucker. But yeah, it's nice to see that kind of standard they're running. At district events, obviously Shettleston had Lynn McKenna as well, who was the Scottish 5K champ. So it's nice to see people coming out for these events and sort of supporting it and stuff like that. Obviously, the sort of main sort of grassroots of the sport, and just sort of competing against folk that you maybe wouldn't usually compete against. Obviously, going for Olympians right through to probably about 50-minute 10K guys. I've seen some guy was turning 80 or something next week or something, was racing. It's mental, isn't it? I don't think any other sport you'd have things like that. It's just, I think it just deserves so much like love and respect and like. So yeah, like nah, the women's race was good, but I think obviously Michael touched on Edinburgh Uni. Like we've had a couple of Edinburgh Uni girls on the stride sort of videos stuff like that, and every one of them has been like so like keen to stress how important that a sort of platform and sort of support group they've got at Edinburgh Uni, and how basically they chose their academic choice to train with this group, and it's maybe something it's lacked in Scotland the last few years is a good female group, you could maybe say, at that sort of age. Like I know there's quite a sort of high dropout rate in sport, of the sport in general, but I think you should both agree that the sort of dropout rate for young girls in the sport's crazy. Like, I think when you look back, like Tower's group, Michael, we obviously had people like Chloe Cowan and sort of like Catherine Gillespie and stuff like that, but obviously like two of the top two in Britain at our age, and the two of them just sort of packed in, and like it's a shame to see things that are happening. So like I think anything we can do, even obviously if that's through like Edinburgh Uni or like anything Stride can do or other sort of female groups, and obviously the kind of thing that Mary McLennan's doing to bring some awareness and sort of support to the girls' like side of things is great. So obviously it was really good to see a sort of a more maybe sort of, I think the women's race is only like 4 seconds between it at the West, between Camus Lang and Shettleston. So like in my like recollection, it's probably one of the closest women's races has been in a long time. So it's definitely good to see in the sport. And I think the Nationals is four legs, isn't it, in the women's team? So I think Camus Lang are
I
maybe
think so.
drafting in a wee surprise target, which maybe make it even stronger. So I think in that sort of front, obviously from our training group, Michael Johnson's group, it'd be really nice to see that sort of front. But obviously you've got the, like Michael touched on, that strength fed in my union, I'm sure Shettleton are calling folks. So I think that could be another really competitive race on the day.
Yeah,
It
I can tell
could
you
be
right
really.
now, Inverclyde AC are They're chomping at the bit. I'll tell you that right now, man. I
What's
mean,
your 1-2-3 then prediction? £5 bet, go.
one. I mean, it'll be tight. It'll be tight. I mean, last year, as the club captain, I was like, right, I've got my team order and the team tactics spot on. I've told Ross Grey not to go La Linty. Just calm down, Ross. And he did.
Tell
He did.
Ryan not to go on the pints the night
And
before. He's
then,
better at that now, to be fair. He's
aye.
matured. He's
Oh,
matured
aye,
well.
Ross, aye. It's like before you would say him, like, just calm. And then you'd just see me be like, "What are you doing?" And then he'd get caught. And but now he's really matured and he's really, I don't know, he's just changed. It's Ryan we need to watch it for. Like, I'll be like, Ryan, just calm down. Like, don't go off too quick.
I wanna back up my boy Ryan Gray here because he had one of the best last laps at Flat and Fast. He had one of the quickest final laps, which shows that he definitely paced it a bit better, to say the least.
Did
Maybe
you see the
went through for
picture
a
of
little
them where it was like Ross, Ryan, their dad, and the wee brother all trying to pin a number in Ryan's vest? I was in stitches.
No.
That sums up the family. They're such a supportive network. I mean, to a fault sometimes. I mean, this was years ago. This was maybe 2016 or so. I know that I want to go too hard on the boys too much, but I remember we were I was getting a lift off at Ross. He was driving us up to Kilmarnock.
How fast is he driving?
He looked, I know he was actually, he was a good boy. He wasn't driving too fast, but he was for the record, for anyone that's watching, he was driving the legal limit. But he was we got, I can't remember if we got there, if we left or something like that, but he realized he didn't have his spikes. And he just went, "I can't believe my dad didn't pack my spikes." I went, "You're an adult boy." I was like, "You need to take it in, you know." So
He's getting
he's
it.
came a long way, you know. He's came a long, long way. But I mean, the Greys are a great supportive family. They're always there for each other. I mean, it's great to see them all still, you know, coming to see the races and that. You know, Robert Junior still sticking in there. Robert Senior, he's obviously he's pretty much all the races, and the boys are adults. I mean, I don't get that kind of support in my family as much as they love me. So, you know,
Yeah.
it's a
I think
really tight-knit group. I
it's like you may see like Ryan and Ross coming through. They're coming through into three boys and it's like they're just trying to outdo each other, seeing sessions and that when they're younger. So you just got competitiveness and they've got to that level now, but they're brilliant, brilliant runners. And I think the likes of like Ryan and Ross. No, Ross won 3 10 Ks in a row in the summer there. Like he made a fortune. Like, just won money. Like they think it was like the Rossi 10K. He won the big one at the Paisley.
Aye.
He beat that boy Lewis Hannigan. I was like,
Yeah.
beat him? That's a very, very
Good
good
stuff.
scalp. And then
Aye.
just to finish it off, he won a race that I've won. I think you've won as well, Carl. The Kilmacombe 10K.
Aye.
Yeah. He won
Back
that.
in the glory
I
days.
know. And I was like, did you get money for it? He's like, aye. I was like, did you? I was like, when I won it, I got a slap in the face and a medal. That was it.
Well, I
How
mean,
you
I've
beat
probably
that?
got the worst prize. Well, I say it's the worst prize. It's not. It was a good prize, but it wasn't money. I came second at the Kilpatrick Caper. I think it's like, I think it's what it's called. It's a hill race. Weirdly, I didn't know who beat me at the time until I looked at the results. It was Mark Austin, who competed. He used to run against us as well when we were younger, but he won bronze at the Commonwealth Games in triathlon. I didn't know who it was until, because I forgot what it looked like. But we won, like, everybody got a watermelon and a bottle of beer. That's what we got. And I'm trying to get some other weird ones. Like, I think at
You
the
say that it's the
Glasgow.
weirdest one you've had, but I've seen that picture all over your dating app, so you can't say that.
What are you
It
looking at my dating
shows.
apps
How does my profile look, Carl?
for?
That'll be the next thing, Stride Athletics dating. Like, meet a runner near you.
Yeah,
Speed dating, quite literally.
I'm desperately lonely. That's why we've pitched that idea,
But
right?
no, to answer your question, Callum, prediction at the national. A. Well, I'm going to say Inverclyde will be going for gold. They will be. Like, that is, Michael will tell you that's the focus for the team. They got so close last year. Like, they actually beat Central's A team, but Central's B team won
Oh,
it.
really?
Yeah,
Nine.
it's like, so I think Inverclyde will medal. So I think for the win, I think it's either going to be Central, Inverclyde, Shettleston or Cambuslang for the win, or Stirling Uni. I think that's going to be the five teams
What about
that are
Edinburgh?
going to be in contention for the podiums
This
just
women's
now.
race?
I
Is
think it's
that?
going to be. Sorry, Callum.
Is this women's race you're predicting?
No,
You
the
can't
men's
be lying.
race.
Oh,
The men's
men's race,
race.
sorry, right, okay,
No,
right.
the women's race, I think, going by the results I've seen, I think Edinburgh Uni, I think
Yeah.
they could be possible. The women's team would be a 1-2. Maybe. But then you've got the Shettleston team there as well, who are. Oh, incredible. That Shelton women's team, they've called they won the national and they won like the Liverpool cross country and they went to European club.
Yeah.
So they might commit they might be a crack performance as well, so
No, I think actually the women's race might be the one to watch.
yeah, I think so too.
I think it's more predictable who will be at the top. As in, I think the top teams will be, as you said, Edinburgh's two teams will likely be up there. I think Central will be half decent. I think we'll have a solid run from Cambuslang and Shelston. I think in terms of tightness between the top three or four, there could be a lot of drama there. I think there'll be more drama. This is my hot take. There'll be more drama than in the men's race. But I will say this much: when you were going through the names there of the teams for the men's, I was thinking, oh, I feel like you missed a couple out. So I mean, I think this is how much depth there's going to be on the men's side. Where I think if we're looking at, and again, I'm the son of a bookie. I'm not a mug. I'm not gonna bet anything on this. But there's a lot of teams. I'm just gonna list them. Obviously, Inverclyde and Cambuslang will be wanting a medal. Shettleston, I think when they get their big hitters in, will also be up there. I think if Gla I don't know what Glasgow Uni's like team is, if that's their strongest team. If it is, then maybe they'll be in amongst the medals. But I think you're looking at Kilbarkin,
Yeah,
Inverclyde.
Kilmartin.
Because I mean, the thing is, like, we've kind of it's a weird one on the West because the West can be quite strong, but I think for years, more on the sixth person teams for like the West in December, it's almost for Inverclyde, Cambuslang, and Shettleston. If you get in the top six counters, you're getting a medal. It's almost that's almost been what it's been like because they're the three biggest teams. But Kilbarkin have definitely got a lot of strength in this. Really, I think they've got a chance of winning it if everything goes well for them. On the east side, Stirling as well. It'll be interesting because they've nicked a couple of the central boys. How that will affect the central team, I think they've still got a really half decent chance. And then possibly even Edinburgh could be up there. Just there's so many teams on the men's side. It's probably a bit less. It's going to sound like a paradox in saying this. I think it's less predictable what order it'll be in, but I think that the women's race will be the one that's a lot tighter, even though it's probably more predictable who will be at the front.
Yeah. And they're saying about Central, I did see Andy Butcher's Instagram story. He was doing a long run in Scotland, so you never know. Maybe a wee sneaky entry from
Think Butcher's
Central.
based in Scotland these days, is he not?
Is he?
I've seen him a couple of times in Kelvin Grove Park with Lindsay, but I could be wrong. But I'm sure someone told me he's based in Scotland again.
I've always wondered that about Butcher and Lindsay. I wonder what their first date was like. I wonder if it was like five times a
Yeah.
K, really. I know that baby's going to have, it's got some genetics, it's got Commonwealth Olympian DNA. It's like
No,
got to be a future Olympian.
I no excuse if they don't make it to the Olympics. That's a bare minimum, isn't it?
Oh
But
yeah, I think it's good.
it's always interesting with Andy because Andy Butcher's a bit of a king of the mind games. You can't he's always teasing that he'll be running, so you never it's good. Sometimes you're like, ah, he's just winding everybody up, but it's quite good because you can sit there sometimes and think to yourself, like, oh, he might turn up, he might just do it, and it keeps people on their toes. I think from a neutral point of view, it would be good to see him there if he is running. I don't know what his plans are.
Yeah,
For every
and
other
Jamie
club,
Crowe's
maybe.
racing maybe as well. I'm sure Jamie mentioned in his Scottish Athletics thing that he was, well, it may not be this race, but I'm sure he mentioned after his half in Glasgow he was going to do some cross country.
Is this Jamie
Yeah, he
Crowe?
did. Yeah,
He did. Yeah. Not big at the thing as well. I felt kind of sorry for Jamie at the Stirling 10K because, like, every year, like, any time I've done the Stirling 10K up at the front, it's all packed. But then that year, I was terrible. I was not in shape at all. But I was coming around to know that. Don't know if you've done Stirling 10K before, but you turn
I've
around to
not,
the right,
no.
down towards the, basically, you head it towards the Wallace Monument, you turn right, then way further down is the turning point. But obviously, Jamie croaking around the corner before I even got to the corner. But he was way out by himself, no, way out, and there was nobody near him. And you're like, in years gone by, you know, he would have been surrounded with loads of our people. I think he was trying to go for a record as well, so felt kind of bad from that day. But it wasn't surprising to see him win the half marathon.
I think he showed it, to be honest.
Yeah, he's a quality athlete. And again, I think it's always worth mentioning, you know, I was kind of joking that from a neutral point of view, we don't want to see people that butcher it. You know, you do want to see people that butcher, but the teams that are wanting to try and win the gold don't. But having these people at the top competing is always going to push everybody else on. You know, I think that's one thing it's always worth. It's worth mentioning. Sometimes you kind of go, I wish I was higher up, but then you would never be as good as you were if you weren't constantly being pushed on by everybody around you as well. So I think it's a really healthy position we're all in as a country, with cross country in particular.
Well, absolutely. It'd be great to see. I think it was 1 year was like Butcher and Callum. They ran the national relays 1 year, both of them, and I think Jake Whiteman did it 1 year as well. No, it was the only person I've not seen that cross country like Scottish one has been Ailish McCaughan, apart from when she's a young girl. But now that she's made it a big time, you know, she's you know, she's not been doing Scottish cross country. I mean, she doesn't need to, I suppose, because her focus is on the track and the road. But it would be, I think it just would be pretty cool. I imagine that in the last lap of the national relay, you've got Josh Kerr for Edinburgh, Callum for Cobarkin, Butcher for Central, and all three of them are, and Ben Petrakis for Inverclyde AC. Because I've got to get
You can't help it.
that in
Always has
there.
to bring. Always has to bring up the stripes. Always.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
No, but I mean,
Just
it's funny
imagine
because
that.
I always think about the fantasy side of it. Like, you know, if you had a couple of really solid club runners in there, and then you had, I don't know, it's rare that this would even happen. But if you had Laura Muir and Ailish McColgan going, do you know what? Do I fancy doing the Nationals? You know,
They're both Dundee, aren't
they're both Dundee Hawke Allies,
they?
so they, you know. If they had a half decent team, I always wonder, you know, if they were a team that were kind of on the verge of a medal anyway, you know, as we sometimes see with those teams with with likes of Kilbarkin or Central or whatever, when they bring in one of the big hitters, sometimes it's like, you know, it's always something you kind of wish you could see, but yeah, maybe it's just a dream.
I
But
think that's a winning team. Ailish, Laura Muir, and Natasha Phillips for Dundee. I think that's nobody's.
Natasha.
Oh, I forgot about her. I don't
Aye,
think
of course.
anyone in Britain's beaten that team.
Yeah. Just
No.
wait till next year the Stride Athletics run team gets put out.
I know. That'd be amazing. But no, I think, especially, I think we see in the Scottish terms, you know, if someone back in the past, it was like if someone made a team, you know, that's incredible. It seems to be a bit of the norm now. But I think Scottish cross country, it just never changes. Like the relays are, the national relay is one of the biggest. I'd say second to the, well, in terms of size, I'd say it's maybe second to the national in February. But I think in terms of like excitement, the national relays is probably more exciting than the national in February, just because it's not just like at the front for the men and the women's and the juniors, but you've got the vet scene is really kind of. There's a lot of quality vet runners now, and I think you get a lot of guys in the vet scene who are vet 35 and vet 40 who came to the sport quite late and they've just improved so much. And we've got a guy, Mark Doherty, in our club. Like, he was a runner years and years ago, and then he stopped, went to uni, went to Edinburgh Uni, didn't run for them though, and met his wife, had a family, now he's back running, and he's absolutely flying. So, and if he's doing Frankfurt Marathon, but there was chat, you know, he would been like, we've got not a bad masters team, and it would just be interesting. It would be quite tight in those, and they see the results coming from the masters, and there's not a lot separating them between the teams now as well. So there's that aspect of it as well. So for me, it's probably the most exciting for a spectator, the most exciting race to watch.
Yeah, I'd agree. It's probably, I think, in terms of Scottish courses off the top of my head, it's probably one of the most sort of spectator friendly courses as well, where you can see a lot of the action going on, which, like you say, makes it a lot more exciting. Yeah, all the courses there was like trees and stuff like that, and it's a bit hard. You can maybe see wee bits, whereas this course is quite open, so it's like, I mean, it's quite hilly, isn't it? It's a bit of pain in the neck trying to get up and down, trying to cheer folk on when you're just running a race, but it's great for your sort of Joe Bloggs to run about and cheer folk on and see what's going on. It's a, I really enjoy it. I think it's a great course. The hills and that just really make it look.
I think what as you were saying, Callum, because it's so spectator friendly and like you can almost hit so many access points. What I love about it, and I mean you're saying about the atmosphere, Sean, I reckon it's probably not really a like a crazy theory. It's probably quite an obvious thing to say, but because you've not got like 400, say for the guys, you know, like 400 guys running at the same time, you've got 100 guys running, and then 100 guys maybe in the pen. And then 200 others who are able to cheer on as they're warming up and stuff like that. So, I mean, that's a big thing where I love the relays. Like, it's one of my favorite parts of the year. The national course, it's not my favorite, to be honest. I don't think anybody really enjoys it. I think if you enjoy it, you're a wee bit of a masochist. But it's a good course, though. You know what I mean? It's just that way. It's like, it's a smart course. It's one if you get it wrong, you get punished. And just the absolute roar you get for people and your teammates like screaming you down the hill and all that, it's one of the best feelings, because as you say, you know, if you're doing nationals, you're not always gonna have that many people cheering you on necessarily, because people are all running at the same time. And I think sometimes the juniors kind of stick a bit for the relays as well, more than for the nationals, where there's like so many races, and if you're under 13, you're not going to stick about for 4 hours to watch the guys at the end and stuff like that. So it's one of my favorite parts of the year. So I'm really looking forward to coming on.
Yeah, me too. I think it'll be. I think I'm marathon training just now, but I think I'm just going to put my long run on the Sunday and do a leg at the National Relay just because I like it. It's I know what you mean. It's not just that as well. You're like spectators and that as well, but most of your team are like falling like you're 18, and it's like if you're up, you've been there before, mate. Well, like, everyone's got their stopwatches out. It's like, if they're sitting in second, they're like, right, it's 10 seconds. And then they get to the next point, they're like, right, that's only 8 seconds now. And just the runners are getting feedback all the time, and it just makes it really exciting. They're like, it really needs to move now. And it's so adrenaline fueled in that as well. And it comes to when they come up with the top half of the course and they make their way back downhill again, it's just that you see the whole crowd just sprinting towards that last wee hill. And it's for me, it's the best race in Scottish athletics. And I think, I don't know if it has been televised in the past, but I think there should be more to like highlight the whole day rather than through phones, etc. I think you can do a wee documentary on that,
I was just gonna say, we'll stick the GoPro on you and do a Sean's POV around the course.
That'll be very slow right now.
Well, no, that's good though. It means we get some good camera quality. Wouldn't be
That's true.
shaggy.
I know, I wouldn't be running that fast just now, so
we can speed it up, time and a half.
Absolutely. Sean is flying, but how can you finish fast?
It's funny though, because I mean it's one thing that I love about the relays as well, is that you have to have a wee bit of kind of savage, you need to have a bit of kind of savagery on you, you know, like as Callum said, he trains with Mike Johnston, but Mike's very gracious and has people from a bunch of different clubs. I don't know how many clubs you could count, Callum, but I joined the group fairly recently, and we've got a bunch of boys from Glasgow Uni who are, you know, when they're not running for them, running for Livingston or Kirstorphine and all that kind of stuff. So we've got a lot of different people from different clubs who, for that 1 hour of Cumbernauld, are just, you know, kind of enemies, depending on where you are in the field. You know, I think if, you know, I always cheer the Canvas Line boys on, for example, but I would probably not be cheering them on as much if it was a bit of neck and neck between the two clubs, for example. I like that kind of feeling of being able to be tribal for an hour before you kind of go back to all being pals, you know?
Yeah, that's what I like about athletics. Like you see, like football, it's just hatred. I've been to plenty of football matches, just hatred everywhere. But with athletics, it's just everyone's there because they're a lovely sport, and there's no hatred, there's no sporting hatred that there at all. Everyone, when you run well, everyone congratulates you, etc. And if you don't have a good run, people are there to like console you, like, oh, don't worry about it, and this and that. That's, you know, what I love about the sport and that as well. And nothing about it as well. Like national relay, I remember going off the fourth leg a few times and they've run by yourself. But I've noticed the last good few times I've been at a national, because I'm club captain now, I make myself first leg, so there's nothing you can do about that, you know, because I make the decision. But I've noticed on the fourth legs, you know, people are getting a lot more company now. And I think that's shown. The Cork Athletics always say, oh, record numbers again. I think that's shown at the sport, especially cross country club level, is getting a lot more popular as well. So that's another really, really good thing to see. And hopefully that can keep going throughout the season, because we've got the West Leagues as well now. I know the East had their cross country league, but the West Leagues, so they've started up last year, which were a great, just a great addition to the West cross country calendar. Did you guys do them at all?
I've done one of them, the one over at East Kilbride.
Yeah.
But I agree. I think it's, it definitely was something that we needed in the sort of West. I think after Christmas, there wasn't really too much in the calendar before Falkirk, especially unless you were doing inter-districts or indoors. I completely agree. I think it's a really nice thing to have in the calendar.
Yeah, because I think before when you, it was like the start of December was the West Cross Country, and it was almost
Like nothing to Falkirk,
12 weeks without no cross. So they filled that wee gap there, which I think is brilliant. So it is. But no, the East Kilbride one was good. That was, I liked that wee course. It was, when you got there, you're like, ah, this is kind of flat. And you're like, no, it's not.
No, it wasn't like anything. There was any flat to it, was it? It was all quite undulating or steep hills. Like my old back went on it, which wasn't nice. So,
oh, that's not a good one.
I thought it was a nice technical. I quite prefer the technical courses. I'm not a big fan of see the sort of that course over at North Lanarkshire where they do the short course on. It's just flat and fast. Like maybe
Oh,
shouldn't like it
we don't
after
like
winning a race.
that,
I'm called that
do
maybe. I much prefer cross country when it's muddy and technical and river cross. I think that's like true like cross country running. I love that stuff. Like I don't like that golf course stuff in America. It's just fake, isn't it? It's like, just give me the true nitty gritty stuff and pray my old back
Yeah.
doesn't go and get me around it. But I much prefer doing that kind of stuff compared to your sprint as fast as you can. Look at the legs anymore.
I see that it's like it was like some American like running channels that shows them, oh, here he is, cross country champion, and you're like, ah, there's no mud. It's like a lawn bowl surface. You're like, where's all the like, no, come over to Scotland or England for that matter and do a proper cross country. I remember years ago at the West, I don't know if you remember, Mick, I don't know if you were, I was only 18 at the time, but it was in East Kilbride, and it was just a quagmire, and then whoever decided what the course was, they decided. So you come off this hill, which was basically just pure mud, like nobody could get up it, like except from the leaders. Like people were just falling face first into this hill, just full of mud. And then you come down off this, and again a muddy hill, people are just falling about everywhere. And then you turn left, and for about 100 meters, he'd obviously had chains with planks of wood, so he just tied them. So you'd have to jump over every single one. And I remember getting to the end and I was absolutely done. I was like, that's probably the most pure cross country like, I've ever done, ever. Because I think that's the way cross country was before. You'd have to jump over things and vault fences and all that and stuff. And
I mean, I'm quite a fan of if they make a couple of, this is maybe a little call out to the ballot organisers. I kind of mind if they're doing West in December or not, but I really like Balloch just because it's a proper. Can you swear on the podcast, Sean?
yeah, of course you can. Fuck
It's
it.
an absolute bastard of a course. I know it's a soft swear, but you know what I mean. I mean, I did call Callum a bastard earlier, but you know what I mean. I just wanted to make sure I could say more than one. But it's a proper bastard of a course. It's not easy. It's really is a again a tester of like your bravado. Like if you're someone that goes out there and it's like, right, I'm gonna smash this, and you get it wrong, you get it wrong. Like I got it a wee bit wrong. I definitely went out a wee bit too fast. Paid for it at the end, but I saw a few people who are in like the top 15 who end up like 30th and stuff like that. But the only thing I would change on that one, and I can't, Callum, did you run that at all?
Which one was that, sorry?
Balloch West.
Nah, the cross country.
Aye.
Yeah, I don't know. I failed on the hill, man. Spikes
All
was
right,
probably
so I think you're
slipped
going to
right
talk.
in.
Oh, wait, did you do the one where it finished on the hill down?
I never got the finish. I had to get carried off.
I ran past you at that point. I was like, I beat Callum. Yes.
I didn't do that. Yeah, but I was watching. I remember there was a boy. Because the thing is, I think I met the guy. He was telling me about this, and I went, I remember watching that. Was that you? Like, because there was this guy just went tumbling down the hill. He just started rolling. But it was the year after that. There was a bit. There was a on a bit of a camber coming around at the side, and on the first lap, we're all just thinking, oh, it's not that bad, and it was really, really slippy, and I failed to get a couple of guys. Was like, spikes are about that. You see the spikes this close to your face as you're sliding. And then on the second lap, I've lost all my momentum by this point. I'm done in, and second lap, just trying to tiptoe in there. And again, like, I nearly fell on my ass again. So it's like, you can't win. You can't win with some of these courses. But it's a real test. It's
Yeah,
a
I know
real
what bit you're
test.
talking about. That
Aye.
was really, really dangerous. There was actually a bit you're coming to. I just literally shuffled along. I was like, I'll get to the hill at the end and I'll start picking up. But there was me and a group of guys, two Garscube guys. One was running up here, one was down here. It was kind of flat. The guy up top slipped, took the other guy out, and then he smashed into a tree. And I was like, this is quite dangerous, actually. Isn't it?
It's
Safe cross country anymore.
proper
It
cross
is,
country.
it's cross country, but a guy like wrapped himself around this tree. I was like, that could have been me, but I kept running. I didn't ask if he was all right at that at all because you're racing, you know what I mean? Each man for their own, you know. But no, I think that's the same day. I think Jerry Gaffney from Riverclyde, he was spectating and fell and, well, slipped and broke his ankle at
I
Dundalk.
mind that now. I did.
No,
I.
that was the same day, Nick Gemmell as well. There's me and him fighting for the sixth spot, and I got a jump on him at the hill, and then I slipped. I was just like, I was like, oh, and then he just couldn't care, and he went for it, and he beat us by like a second. And I always say to myself, like, Sean, you shat yourself downhill. And that's what cost you a team medal.
There you go.
I know.
On
Lesson
that
learned.
note.
I know. On that note, Nick Gemmell's now left us to go to Garscube now, so.
I saw him actually on a after a run Sunday, Callum. Popped
Oh, yeah.
into pop bumped into him
I used to be shouting to Nick
and
Gemmell because, Michael, you know, like, Nick Gemmell, like, he went from, he started off like over 3 hours for a marathon, and then just at Berlin there, he ran 2:33. But for the last, like, 6 years, he's just did a marathon every 6 months, block, 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 block,
Right.
and he's improved by over half an hour. And he
And he's
does,
like 50 something, isn't he? Like
I
50,
think
well,
he's
51 or
50 now,
something.
and
Aye.
I think he does all his runs by himself as well. Like,
Aye,
it's all
he's
solo runs.
brilliant.
Like, how does he do that mentally? It's just, oh, he's, oh, it's incredible. So that's a wee shout out for that game over there. But yeah, but no, we'll maybe do another wee cross country, maybe version after Christmas to see how if our predictions have went right. But Callum, what's your predictions?
I was keeping quite quiet there, wasn't
Aye.
I? In the men's side, I don't know if Callum's racing again, but I think if Callum's racing, I think Kobarkin might have it. I think in the men's side, I think Callum might be quite determined to. I think he was seventh or something fastest at the West. I think he might be able to just maybe try and put a marker down again. So I wouldn't need to look past Kobarkin in the men's side. And then I think maybe top three could be quite close. I don't know who Central will put out, but I'd imagine they'll be there or thereabouts. And then aye, and McLeod, I think that's probably my top three. It's probably not quite a similar top three the last 4 or 5 years they're into it. It's usually between them
Yeah,
three. And then the
he's
women's side, I think Edinburgh Uni are obviously the favourites, aren't they, with that depth. And then I'd back Camus Lang, obviously MJ Elite,
why?
and then Shettleston. I'd say probably Camus Lang, Shettleston, and Edinburgh Uni for the women's side.
Aye, I think it'll be cracking. Was it 2 weeks this weekend? So
Yeah,
that's.
I think it'll be a very good race. That's why I wish I wasn't racing, just to spectate, but
Yeah,
if only
I
we had
know.
somebody, only if only we had a Scottish media channel interested in athletics to film it. I know.
Yeah, we're kind of cursed in that we're all runners, and that's what makes it such a, again, hey, saying the word, authentic channel that's coming up with, you know, content that we know people will want to watch. But at the same time, we really do need to either get one of us injured who can stand on the sidelines with a camera or recruit. So if you're listening to this and you don't like running, I don't know why you'd be listening to the podcast, but you know, if you aren't a runner, by all means, we could always do with someone to hold a camera if we ever think about doing stuff like that in the future, which would always be something we might think about. So
But
it'd
Callum,
be
do you know what
great.
I'll do for you? See, for the national, I'll put Hoosty on one of the first legs, okay? So then he can warm down with the camera. How's that sound?
Sounds good to me.
Right.
And then we can work something out, and we'll put the maybe put the camera on Michael the first leg to film it, and then just a Michael perspective. But I don't know anybody would want to watch that. I'd probably get zero views at Michael.
No, that's because the camera wouldn't be facing me, mate. That's why.
Huh?
Lots of heavy breathing though, so I don't know if anybody would really want to be interested in hearing that. But
Maybe breathing in lots of arms like this.
aye, lots of chubby arms, aye.
I'll put a wee poll. Who would you want to see, Michael or Sean's GoPro?
None.
None. I know. But no, thank you very much, guys, for coming on. And thank you for, you know, it was a great good chat about Stride Athletics and what your plans are. And we've both, you know, I'm really, really glad the stuff you're saying, because that's one of the main reasons why I started this podcast as well, to, you know, just highlight Scottish running, because I do think, you know, the whole thing about Noah Lyles was like the US, what is it, the Knicks or something, he's like that, yeah, basketball world champions are what the
Yeah.
USA, and I've been saying that for years. I was like, they only play in America, and when he's even, so it's not even just that, like club level, athlete level, it's even that a world champion sprinter, like in his media, he's just like, oh, he's world champion. Nah, right, cool. See you later after
Yeah.
one day. So I'm really glad you guys are on the same wavelength and try to promote Scottish running and identifying that we are in a really good place with it as well.
Yeah.
And with the cross country, I think it's just really good to have a really good be pre cross country national relay chat, and we can come back to it and say, oh, well, Sean's right, Inverclyde did win, you
Hopefully.
know.
Aye, but we'll be busy over the winter period anyway. We'll be putting out videos every week on the channel and hopefully bringing you some nice stuff over Christmas and New Year. Just to kind of look forward a teaser, but we will be bringing back Flat and Fast in September, and we are considering a second event, albeit nothing confirmed yet, but we'll be announcing that on our channel on Instagram, which is at stride.athletics. And you can follow us on Facebook and Twitter as well. And we have just launched. Have we launched it yet, Cal? The website?
Not yet. Couple weeks, hopefully. Yeah, a couple of wee
Okay,
things. Yeah.
right.
Well, there's a
We're
wee. If
really
you stayed to the end, there you go. There's a wee
there
teaser.
you go. There's a wee spoiler for you. But yeah, we'll be bringing all that to you. So if you want to kind of keep an eye on what we're doing, see if we're bringing you any new races or anything like that, then we'll be doing it through our Stride channels. Yeah, and thanks again, Sean.
Brilliant. Thank you, guys.
No,
And
cheers for having us. Much appreciated.
no problem at all. And well, you gave your guys a teaser. Well, this is the first of two episodes to go out this week, so we've got a guest coming on for you on, it'll be this weekend at some point. But yeah, all I'm going to say is our guest is a world record holder.
Oh, let me think. I bet it's is it Michael Phelps?
No, he's a swimmer.
Didn't specify in athletics, I'm just saying.
He's a world record holder in athletics.
Interesting. I've got a few ideas, but we'll just wait and see, maybe.
Right,
Callum, do you want
guys.
to go?
Now, do you want a wee guess, Callum, before we go?
Do I want a guest? No, do you want a wee
Guess.
guess of who the guest is coming on? I think it's an ultra runner.
No.
No? No, I don't
Oh, there we go then. We'll
know.
wait and
No.
see.
Maybe wait and see. Well, guys, thank you very much, and I'll see you all very, very soon.